Bah, sôm chuyên cười.
The President.
Veuillez vous asseoir.
Please be seated.
Ông chung nung chung rea tu la ca cầm pool và ca.
The President, the court is now in session. The greffiers, could you please report to us whether the parties to the proceeding are present? The greffier, Mr. President, all parties are present except lawyers for the civil parties. Mr. Karim Khan is absent.
Karim Khan, avocat des parties civiles. Absent aujourd'hui.
Mrs. Moch Savanari is also absent,
est également absent,
along with Kim Minki.
Ainsi que Maître Kim Minki.
Mon nom chapa da cho đo vẹt thì pi nấy cứ
Before we proceed with the second session. We would like to inform parties to the proceedings that
j'informe les parties de ceci.
Your oral submission should be in a slower pace to make sure that
vous interveniez et parliez de façon plus lente, de sorte qu'il soit possible de
vous interpréter correctement. I would like now to hand the floor to the court reporter judge to report on the crimes against humanity.
Concernant la question des crimes contre l'humanité.
Thank you, Mr. President. The second ground of the co-prosecutor's appeal is that the trial judgment erred in law by subsuming specific crimes against humanity under the crime of persecution on political grounds. The co-prosecutors submit that the accused should have been convicted cumulatively for all the acts constituting crimes against humanity for which he was found responsible. Let us recall that the trial judgment found the accused individually criminally responsible for the following offenses as crimes against humanity: murder, extermination, enslavement, imprisonment, torture, and this including one instance of rape, and persecution on political grounds and other inhumane acts. The trial chamber convicted the accused of persecution on political grounds and held that other crimes against humanity are subsumed under this conviction. In short, as the matter will be expertly argued before us, we recall that co-prosecutors submit that the trial chamber erred by subsuming other, under persecution on political grounds, the other crimes against humanity for which the accused was found responsible. The prosecutors argue that each crime against humanity for which the accused was found responsible has a materially distinct element not found in the others. The trial chamber's failure to convict the accused of all the crimes against humanity for which he was found responsible undermines the twin aims of cumulative convictions, as it does not fully reflect the accused's individual criminal responsibility or the actual extent of his involvement in the commission of the crimes. They further submit that any rationale for not allowing cumulative convictions discussed in the international jurisprudence does not apply in this case. Specifically, in the prosecutor's view, the accused is not eligible for parole, and the likelihood that the accused will leave Cambodia for another jurisdiction, much less be convicted in another jurisdiction, is effectively non-existent.
auquel cas il aurait pu être condamné dans une autre juridiction.
The trial chamber failed to fully consider the societal interests protected by each enumerated crime, and that more complete description of the accused criminal conduct was needed for the sake of posterity and the court's historical record. The co-prosecutors further submit that the trial chamber erred in law by subsuming the crime against humanity of rape under the crime against humanity of torture, and by characterizing the single instance of rape as a component of torture.
Et en qualifiant plutôt le cas de viol
the
comme
co-prosecutors
élément
request
de torture.
That the Supreme Court chamber convict the accused of the discrete crime against humanity of rape.
La chambre de la Cour suprême
no written responses were filed
du crime
to the co-prosecutors' appeal.
De viol en tant que crime contre l'humanité.
For the purpose of this appeal hearing, the Supreme Court recalls that the addressing of legal issues of multiple convictions, and in particular the application of the test for multiple convictions as offered by the prosecution, is based in comparisons between concurring criminal definitions. Therefore, the disposing of the appeal has, as a necessary predicate condition, that the Chamber examine the appropriateness of the criminal definitions employed for this test. Examining those definitions is necessary to ascertain the jurisdiction of this court and ultimately for deciding if the Chamber were to enter any of the convictions sought by the appeal. Accordingly, the Chamber provided for the parties for an opportunity to comment on the relevant legal notions of crimes against humanity, persecution, rape, and enslavement.
Judge Sun read. The third ground of the co-prosecutor's appeal is that the trial chamber erred in law by incorrectly defining enslavement and, as a consequence, the trial chamber failed to convict the accused for the enslavement of all the detainees of S21. Regarding the allegation of enslavement in case 001, the trial chamber noted that the amended closing order under the heading of enslavement stated the following. Certain detainees at S21 and Preissau were forced to work. Strict control and constructive ownership were exercised over all aspects of their lives by limiting their movement and physical environment, taking measures to prevent and deter their escape, and subjecting them to cruel treatment and abuse. As a result of these acts, detainees were stripped of their free will. The trial chamber held that the crimes against humanity of enslavement is characterized by the perpetrator's exercise of any or all of the powers attaching to the right of ownership over a person. The trial chamber listed forced labor as one of the indicia of enslavement, and it also stated that forced or involuntary labor may constitute enslavement. The trial chamber found that S21 staff deliberately exercised total power and control over the S24 detainees and over a small number of detainees assigned to work within the S21 complex. These detainees had no right to refuse to undertake the work assigned to them and did not consent to their conditions of detention. The trial chamber therefore found that their forced or involuntary labor compared with their detention amounted to enslavement. The co-prosecutor submitted that the trial chamber erred in law by requiring forced or involuntary labor as a necessary element of enslavement rather than as an indicium of enslavement. The co-prosecutor submitted that as a consequence of incorrectly defining enslavement, the trial chamber failed to convict the accused for the enslavement of a broader group of detainees, namely all the detainees at S21, irrespective of whether they were subjected to forced or involuntary labor. According to the co-prosecutors, the trial judgment already contains adequate findings that powers attaching to the right of ownership were exercised at S21, which fulfill the definition of requirements for enslavement as a crime against humanity. Moreover, those acts were committed intentionally and with the purpose of exercising ownership over the detainees. The co-prosecutors request that the Supreme Court chamber accordingly convict the accused for the crime against humanity of enslavement in respect of all the detainees at S21, irrespective of whether they were subjected to forced or involuntary labor. No written responses were filed to the co-prosecutor's appeal. Thank you, Mr. President. The President, may we invite the co-prosecutor to make a oral submission in response to
procureur à faire des observations concernant ces deux points.
May it please the court. Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, Your Honours. Good morning, Council. In the space of 45 minutes, I'm going to attempt to address the issues that have been raised. They are substantial issues, and I'm going to have to abbreviate in order to get through all of the issues which were discussed by the rapporteurs. The first issue that I will deal with is the issue of cumulative charging for crimes against humanity. By this question that has been put to the co-prosecutors, I'm not going to simply repeat paragraphs 134 to 191 of our submission, but I would ask you to consider that when you are determining this issue. What I aim to do is to provide you with the current legal basis for cumulative charging, and then to very briefly discuss with you any effect on sentencing. Our argument, put quite simply, is this. The trial chamber's interpretation of the law in its judgment in respect of cumulative convictions was wrong. The misapplication of that law can be found at paragraph 565 of the trial judgment. The trial chamber, in essence, decided to ignore the majority judgment in the 2004 Yugoslav Tribunal Appeals Judgment of Kordic, and that is 71 in our table of authorities within our appeal. While this chamber, and indeed the trial chamber, is and was not bound by international jurisprudence, the majority judgment in that case is, in my submission, Your Honours, where the guidance lies on this issue.
À notre sens, qu'il faut chercher
for the sake of consistency and indeed legality, it is my submission that the trial chamber should have followed the majority judgment in that case. This court, whilst a domestic court, has many features of an international court. It will hear very few cases, and the likelihood is that legal scholars, other courts dealing with these very serious offences, will look to this institution now and in the future to find guidance on the interpretation of both substantive and procedural issues in respect of international criminal law. It is my submission that there is an obligation, respectfully, that we create a consistent body of law.
suivre et d'être cohérent avec ces décisions précédentes. Avant d'examiner les décisions rendues dans l'affaire Cordich, je voudrais dire très rapidement quel est ce concept de déclaration cumulative de responsabilité.
As Judge Millard said, convicting an individual of more than one criminal offense upon the basis of the same conduct.
Sur la base des mêmes actes.
Why are individuals convicted of different charges for the same conduct? Well, for the two legal policy factors that Judge Millard mentioned, that multiple convictions protect and recognize different interests, and more importantly, most importantly here, particularly for this court, that there is a proper historical record of convictions to fully describe what the respondent did. These two matters are indeed law, and we cite them in our brief, and you will find them cited in international case law. I won't go through all of that case law, but you will find these principles discussed at paragraph 347 of the appeals judgment in the Musima case. That's authority number 90 in our table of authorities, also in the Akyesu case, that's A-K-A-Y-E-S-U, that's number 84 in our table of authorities, and that's at paragraph
468.
Just as a side note, let me put this in perspective for you.
Je voudrais the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal
will have charged 160 individuals by the time it finishes its work. So that court's record is fulsome in providing a proper, accurate historical record of what actually took place and for which crimes people were charged and either convicted or acquitted. The many human interests that were ruptured in that war in Yugoslavia have been recognized in the charges laid at the feet of the accused. Let me put this in perspective in this case. The trial judgment has found that this man, who presided over mass executions of adults and children through indescribably brutal methods, beaten and stabbed to death, blood drawn from living bodies, a prison population enslaved, conditions of detention hitherto unrepeated since the Second World War, words barely serve their suffering and misery. Fellow human beings robbed of due process, tortured, beaten, the murder and extermination of no fewer than 12,272 living souls. And as we stand today, there will be a single conviction in this case for the crime against humanity and persecution. This does not recognize all of the interests that were ruptured by this man's acts, nor does it serve austerity, truth, or reconciliation as a proper record of what happened. What does it say to the future generations of this country about what this man did, and mostly to his own people? I would ask you respectfully to have these factors at the forefront of your mind when you are determining this issue. Now let me move to the legal test. The legal test is laid down in a decision commonly called the Celibidache decision, also known as the Prosecutor and Mucic. It's a Yugoslav tribunal decision. It's number 83. In our table of authorities.
Et c'est le numéro 83 de notre liste des sources.
Multiple criminal convictions entered under different statutory provisions, but based on the same conduct, are permissible only if each statutory provision involved has a materially distinct element not contained in the other.
Un élément fondamentalement distinct pour chacun des crimes.
An element is materially distinct from another if it requires proof of a fact not required by the other. I think an example that I give to the court will make this test clearer. but you will find the test laid down in paragraph 412 of that judgment.
Vous en trouverez aussi des exemples au paragraphe 42
de la décision Celebici. It is fair to say that in the ensuing years at the Yugoslav tribunal, differing views were taken about this particular test. But what we can say, what my submission is certainly in the limited time available to me, is that the current law is set out in a 2004 decision of the ICTY, which I've already mentioned, and that's the case of Cordic. What the appeals chamber said was this: what is required is an examination as a matter of law of the elements of each offence in the statute that pertain to that conduct for which the accused has been convicted. It must be considered whether each offence charged has a materially distinct element not contained in the other. That is, whether each offence has an element that requires proof of a fact not required by the other offence. And that, Your Honour, you will find in paragraph 1040 of the Cordic judgment. So, for example,
de la Recordic.
At paragraph 1041 of that appeals judgment, addressing the crimes against humanity of persecution and murder, the judges stated that persecution has these two elements: one, requirement of proof that an act or omission discriminates in fact, and two, proof that the act or omission was committed with specific intent to discriminate. Those are the two elements of persecution. The judges then address the crime against humanity of murder. Murder contains an element not contained in persecution. It is proof that the accused caused the death of one or more persons, regardless of whether the act or omission causing the death discriminates in fact or was specifically intended as discrimination which is not required by persecutions. So the judges in that case were looking on the face of it, on the elements required for the offences, and finding that these two offences contain materially distinct elements. And this test has been applied as recently as last year in the Popovic
decision,
also a decision of the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal, and that you will find at paragraph at number 78 of our list of authorities. The one crime which that judgment indicates, or the two crimes, the crimes that cannot be found together in that judgment are extermination and murder, because murder does not contain an element that's materially distinct from extermination. So murder, under the current law, would have to be cumulated. It would have to be subsumed into the crime of extermination, and that you will find in the Popovic judgment. But certainly the trial chamber applied that law in Popovic. Sentencing. I've been asked to consider, the co-prosecutors have been asked to consider the effect on sentencing. The Celibici case, which I've already mentioned, is quite helpful in terms of sentencing. It gives a summary of practices across many jurisdictions, and obviously examines both civil law and common law systems, and essentially comes very briefly to the conclusion that a sentence for cumulative convictions can be global, so a single sentence for a number of different offences. It can be concurrent, so a series of penalties running one after the other, or it can be consecutive in the sense that you can have multiple convictions and multiple sentences that run alongside each other. As you know, the trial chamber in this case essentially imposed a global sentence for all of the convictions, for the conviction of the crime against humanity and for the grave breaches. One issue, which is my submission, will not be a factor that has a great influence on the outcome, but I will mention it here.
Une grande influence sur le résultat final.
The crime against humanity of persecution requires a discriminatory intent.
The other crimes against humanity
that we list, for which the accused was found responsible but not ultimately convicted, do not require discriminatory intent. And it has been found, and indeed the trial chamber found this too, that where that discriminatory intent, the persecution exists, it is an aggravating factor in respect of those other crimes against humanity that do not require this special form of intent. I've also been asked very briefly to address the effect of cumulative convictions on the eligibility for early release,
and
it is our position that since this accused is not eligible for early release, it will not in any way affect him. The co-prosecutors have always maintained that he is not eligible for release. We maintain that now. It's solely for this court to enforce the respondent's sentence. Within the ad hoc tribunals, individuals were sent to serve their sentence in other jurisdictions where judges pointed out at the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal that those multiple convictions within that particular jurisdiction could have a detrimental effect on the accused. But since he will serve his sentence here, that is not of concern to us. Equally, two judges within the ICTY pointed out that the application of habitual offenders laws could also be of a valid concern, where if an individual is convicted of multiple offences and then serves a sentence in a jurisdiction which has a special penalty known as the habitual offenders penalty for multiple convictions, then of course that would be to his detriment. But again, this law, these comments specifically apply to the Rwanda and Yugoslav tribunals where individuals will be sent to different jurisdictions in order to serve their sentence. I'm now, Your Honours, going to move on to the issue of rape as a discrete crime against humanity. We've been asked to explore whether rape was an autonomous crime against humanity under international law during the temporal jurisdiction of the court. The grounds of our appeal are contained in paragraphs 196 to 208. I would point out before I commence my submissions that the trial chamber did find that rape comprises a separate and recognized offense within ECC law and international criminal law. And by making these submissions, I'm in no way disputing that finding, which is at paragraph 366 of the trial judgment. The trial chamber, as I've said, determines that one incident of rape should be categorized as a crime against humanity of torture. We submit that the trial chamber erred in law by failing to convict the respondent of rape. We note that the elements of the offense of rape as a discrete crime against humanity are the same as when rape is subsumed into torture, save for the additional legal requirements of torture. The test, what I'm saying here, Your Honours, is that the test is more stringent for rape when it's subsumed into torture than it would be for rape to be found as a discrete crime in itself. In the present case, where the elements are made out for torture as well, there would be no detriment to the rights of the accused if he were to be convicted of rape as well, and this would more accurately reflect the nature of the criminal conduct. We recognize that in a recent decision of the pre-trial chamber in the second case that will be heard by this court, that there was an examination of whether or not rape was a discrete crime against humanity. The pre-trial chamber in that case found that rape could not be prosecuted in this court in its own right, but that it could be prosecuted under the category of a crime against humanity, of inhumane acts. We take issue with that characterization and that application of the principle of legality. Our argument, simply put, is that the principle of legality does not require that a crime has been prescribed in the exact and precise terms in which it is later prosecuted, as long as it was reasonably foreseeable and accessible to the accused that certain acts or omissions would entail international criminal liability. Thus, so long as it is established that the conduct of rape could constitute a crime against humanity during 1975 to 1999, it's irrelevant whether the conduct would have been charged under the name of rape as a crime against humanity on the one hand or rape as an inhumane act on the other.
Cela n'est pas pertinent au regard du principe
as
d'acte
stated in Hadzi Hasanović at the Yugoslav tribunal, the principle of legality is satisfied if the underlying criminal conduct as such was punishable, regardless of how the concrete charges in a specific law would have been formulated. So the question, in my respectful submission, that you should ask yourselves is whether conduct amounting to rape was punishable as a crime against humanity such that it was accessible and foreseeable that the accused could be prosecuted for crimes against humanity based on that conduct during the temporal jurisdiction of this court.
La période pour lesquelles les
it is our position that the accused could have reasonably foreseen that acts of rape could constitute a crime against humanity as of 1975. Why do I say that?
Un crime contre l'humanité.
In the Kunarac's decision, the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal, that's Authority 73 in our list of authorities,
numéro 73 dans la liste des sources,
rape was described as one of the worst sufferings a human being can inflict upon another, and the court found that it had been long prohibited in customary international law. The pre-trial chamber of this court further recognized itself that rape has long been prohibited as a war crime in international humanitarian law, and that is the decision on appeal by Munchir and Ying Tirit of the closing order, and you'll find that at paragraph 151 of the pretrial chamber's judgment. We submit that the prohibition of rape as an autonomous crime against humanity gradually crystallized out of the prohibition of rape in authorities which actually date back to the 19th century. I do not have time to go through each one of these in detail, but very briefly, these authorities are those, in fact, that were cited by the pretrial chamber. It includes Article 44 of the Liber Code, which was a code of practice, a code that was put in place for the conduct of war during the American Civil War, and the federal authorities expressly prohibited rape being committed by their own armed forces. The regulations annexed to the 1907 Hague Conventions, the Geneva Conventions of 1949, the Additional Protocol of 1977, and the Additional Protocol also of 1977. All of these instruments prohibit sexual violence and rape.
la violence sexuelle.
Other sources that further evidence the gradual prohibition of rape in customary international law is the 1919 Commission of Responsibility of the Authors of War and Enforcement of Penalties. This was a report that was produced by the victorious powers at the end of the First World War. The recommendations were to bring in particular, the Emperor of Germany and German officers to trial
for crimes committed during the First World War.
Rape was listed fifth amongst the 32 charges enumerated by that commission. Now, it is fair to say that no trials actually took place as a result of that commission's report. There were trials that were conducted by the German authorities, but there was a lack of political will to have international trials. Nevertheless, that is what the great powers of that time agreed was the law. Later, in 1945, after the end of the Second World War, rape was expressly classified as a crime against humanity under Article 2C of the Control Council Law No. 10, a law that was promulgated to try the major bulk of war criminals in Germany after the war. The International Military Tribunal tried the main senior members of the Nazi regime. Control Council Law No. 10 was set up in order to try the vast majority of individuals who were susceptible to prosecution for war crimes and crimes against humanity. Now, again, whilst those provisions of Control Council Law No. 10 contained rape as a crime against humanity, no accused was tried for the crime of rape.
Traduit en justice pour le crime de viol.
That said, scholars have indeed pointed out that evidence was in fact heard during the main trial, the International Military Tribunal for Rape, whilst it wasn't classified as an inhumane act, because within the charter of the Nuremberg Court of the International Military Tribunal, rape was regarded as an inhumane act. Nevertheless, evidence of rape was heard in that case. And indeed, moreover, the International Military Tribunal for the Far East also included inhumane acts, and evidence also was heard in that case of rape. Now, moving forward in time, and we must move forward rapidly, and I must move forward rapidly because I'm running out of time. Both the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal and the Rwanda Tribunal provided for the prosecution of rape as an autonomous crime against humanity. Although these instruments, the statutes that established these courts, enumerated these crimes in the early 1990s, there had been no development of the law in respect of rape between the end of the Second World War and the beginning of the 1990s. The first international criminal prosecution for rape as a crime against humanity was in the Akiyesu case. The trial chamber in Akiyesu decided in their 1998 judgment that rape was an autonomous crime against humanity. In doing so, pioneering and courageous judges of that trial chamber recognized the horrors of sexual violence and the lasting silent human destruction, both to individuals and to our societies. Subsequently, the findings of the Rwanda Tribunal with respect to the status of rape as a crime against humanity were confirmed by the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal in addressing the horrors of the Kunarats case and the Special Court for Sierra Leone in the Samanza case. The co-prosecutors submit that it is appropriate for this court to follow the settled body of international criminal jurisprudence on this issue. Although neither the Yugoslav Tribunal, the Rwanda Tribunal, or the Special Court for Sierra Leone identified the precise point at which rape crystallized as a crime against humanity in customary international law, it is my submission that it must have occurred in the wake of the Second World War at the latest, because as I've said, there were no significant conventional or jurisprudential developments related to the crime against humanity of rape between 1945 and 1993.
Entre 1945 et
the trial chamber of this court has established that reliance on decisions of tribunals post-1979 does not contravene the principle of legality. So looking forward to decisions that were made later to interpret the law that came from behind is something that the trial chamber has said is lawful, and I would ask you respectfully to do the same, because that guidance provides interpretation as to the evolving status of certain offences and forms of responsibility in international law.
Certaines infractions requièrent Similarly, de la responsabilité
the Yugoslav Tribunal in Hadzianovic noted that the principle of legality, jurisprudence in the European Court of Human Rights allows for the gradual clarification of the rules of criminal liability through judicial interpretation and reflects the understanding that it's not necessary that the elements of an offence are defined, but rather that general description of the prohibited conduct be provided. Now, in my submission, this makes absolute sense to allow a process of gradual explanation of international norms through judicial interpretation, considering the nature of the international legal system. Where norms have not been codified in the manner that offences would be codified in a domestic system.
Comme par exemple les infractions international law, Your Honours,
as you know, is not a product of domestic statute. There's no world authority yet that's empowered to enact statutes of universal application. It's elucidated often through judicial decisions. To find otherwise, to apply strict domestic principles would have strangled international law at birth.
Et d'appliquer strictement du droit national aurait déjà étouffé le droit international.
Was not part of customary international law would, in my submission, also undermine the consistent findings of international criminal tribunals, which allow for rape to be prosecuted as an autonomous crime against humanity. The determination of the international tribunals in respect of rape rests upon the same authorities that are available to you, Your Honours. As I've said, there were no significant developments between 79 and 93. In sum, Your Honours, there is no reason to depart from the criminalisation of rape as a crime against humanity in the law. In this court, in particular, very briefly, both prongs of the principle of legality stand and are satisfied. With respect to foreseeability, the pre-trial chamber has found that a charged person must be able to appreciate that the conduct is criminal in the sense generally understood without reference to any specific provision. Applying that standard, to the present case, the co-prosecutor submit that the prohibition of rape in international customary law was sufficiently developed in 1975 such that the accused could have foreseen that acts of rape constituted a crime against humanity. The fact that the crime previously may have been charged in a less specific fashion is irrelevant for the legality analysis, since the underlying conduct is exactly the same. The second prong of the test is the legality test. The second prong of the legality test, I'm sorry, is the accessibility requirement. And the pre-trial chamber has recognized that with respect to the accessibility prong, reliance can be placed on a law which is based on custom. Here, the information necessary to come to this conclusion that rape was punishable as a crime against humanity in customary international law was public and accessible. Just because it wasn't in a domestic statute does not mean to say that the accused can argue that he didn't have access to that law. It was established in international customary law by the time of this offence. An analogy can be made to the practice of the Yugoslav and Rwanda tribunals, where perpetrators of rape in the context of widespread and systematic, horrific attacks in the former Yugoslavia were found to have had sufficient notice that their conduct amounted to a crime against humanity, that sexual violence, that those rapes was a crime against humanity, and they knew it. Lastly, international criminal jurisprudence establishes that or the appalling character of an act must play a role in warranting the criminalisation of that act, insofar as it can refute any claim that an accused did not know
malgré toute affirmation d'un accusé s'il dit qu'il ne savait pas que l'acte était criminel. Et vous pouvez retrouver cela dans la décision Miletinovic,
au paragraphe 42,
il s'agit d'un arrêt de la chambre d'appel du tribunal pour
l'ex-Yougoslavie.
Je vais maintenant parler de la réduction en esclavage.
The Chamber has requested submissions from us on the issue of enslavement, and in particular regarding the apparent discrepancy between the closing order's charging of enslavement, which appears to charge enslavement with respect to certain detainees rather than all detainees, and the argument in the OCP.
Et les procureurs, dans la fin de l'appel, les procureurs, nous disons que la réduction de l'esclavage s'est faite pour tous les détenus de
S21.
Pour ce qui est de la définition de la réduction de l'esclavage, je référence au paragraphe 342 de la décision de la chambre
en première instance.
Enfin, je considère que la
forced labor. I think that just in these particular circumstances,
they found that enslavement was taking place
with the element of forced labor. In any event,
our position on the law
is contained in our submissions, and I won't repeat that here. It's always been the position of the co-prosecutors that all detainees were enslaved in S21, and you can find those submissions at paragraph 273 and 274 of our final submission to at the end of the first case. That submission clearly identifies also both the groups forced to work at S24 and all of the detainees of S21 as having been enslaved. Now, the closing order from OCIJ in this case, as I've already stated, says the following, and I'll read it. Certain detainees at S21 and Presar were forced to work. Strict control and constructive ownership was exercised over all aspects of their lives by limiting their movement and physical environment, taking measures to prevent and deter their escape, and subjecting them to cruel treatment and abuse. As a result of these acts, detainees were stripped of their free will. Now, I will accept immediately how this chamber may come to the conclusion that the investigating judges were limiting or establishing a subset of individuals who were subjected to enslavement, that it didn't involve anybody. But I would make the following submission. Certainly, if you read all of the preambular paragraphs in the closing order prior to paragraph 135, and I won't have time to go through all of them, but certainly if you look at paragraphs 62, 63, 66, and that's in respect of Toulsling, S21, the judges address facts which are clearly enslavement, not based on forced labour. Prisoners being blindfolded and handcuffed. Prisoners being restrained for 24 hours a day. One prisoner, Chum May, explained that he was not allowed to stand up. Rules governing the lives of prisoners, depriving them of their most basic human needs, unable to speak to each other or to the guards. Prisoners shackled when
bailed.
My submission is that even though paragraph 135 appears to limit the if you look at the last sentence, it states, as a result of these acts, detainees were stripped of their free will. My submission, Your Honours, is that these paragraphs should be read as a narrative, in the sense that all of the facts that were referred to beforehand are actually incorporated in paragraph 135, if you read the whole thing as a narrative, what actually happened at S21 and S24. And I think
cela
that the final sentence
of paragraph 135 supports my argument in this respect.
In any event, Your Honours, if you don't accept
toutefois,
that argument,
si vous n'acceptez pas
it is my submission that you do have the authority, as the trial chamber did, to recharacterize this particular charge that's provided for by Rule 110.2 of the rules of procedure of the internal regulations of that court, which says that the judgment shall be limited to the facts set out in the indictment that the chamber, referring to this chamber, may change the legal characterization of the crime as set out in the indictment as long as no new constitutive elements are introduced.
Tant et aussi longtemps que de nouveaux éléments constitutifs n'ont pas été présentés.
In terms, as I've already said, of the element of forced labour, whether or not one takes the position
forcé,
that the trial chamber erroneously inserted forced labour into the definition of enslavement, or whether or not they said enslavement could take place with or without forced labour, it is our position that forced labour is not a requirement for enslavement, and that this chamber can enter a conviction for the enslavement of all of the detainees who were detained at S21.
On peut reconnaître que tous les détenus de S21 ont été réduits en esclavage.
Next, I will move very briefly in the time I have left to make submissions on the factual elements of extermination and enslavement on the facts of this case. This, of course, goes back to what I was saying earlier about cumulative convictions.
Cela revient à ce que je disais tout à l'heure sur le cumul des déclarations de culpabilité.
What I will do is simply outline for you the materially distinct elements of the offence of extermination and then the offence of enslavement. Extermination requires an act or omission or a combination of each that results in the death of the other. That's not an element of enslavement.
Ce n'est pas un élément de la réduction de l'esclavage.
Enslavement requires the exercise of powers pertaining to rights of ownership over a human being. That's not an element in extermination.
Now,
in terms of the facts of this case, one can distinguish between those facts where conditions of detention led to death, which can be extermination, and then conditions of detention that essentially were enslavement.
Qui n'était autre que d'une réduction en esclavage.
Again, very briefly, those conditions of detention which led to enslavement,
détention qui ont mené à
you will find
réduction en esclavage,
in the closing order
at
paragraph 66, paragraph 63,
63,
paragraph 62,
62
and paragraph 64,
et 64 de la décision de renvoi.
Thus, it is my submission that both the distinction between extermination and enslavement would allow for a conviction for both offences, and moreover, that the facts that the trial chamber found and indeed are contained in the closing order would support those two different convictions. There were individuals, very few I know, who survived the conditions of detention at S21. Many people perished, it's true. But there were some individuals who survived
de
and were
mortes,
subjected to conditions of detention that amounted to enslavement.
Des conditions de détention qui n'étaient autre qu'une réduction d'esclavage.
Very, very briefly, Your Honours, because I think I'm probably almost out of time. I have 3 minutes left.
Il me reste 3 minutes, me dit-on.
The issue of persecution,
la question de persécution
as a crime against humanity.
En tant que crime contre l'humanité.
We tend to support the findings of the trial chamber.
Nous,
there's not a great deal we can add. I could very quickly go through the customary international law, the findings of the trial chamber, paragraphs 374 to 396,
in respect of crimes against humanity and persecution.
But I think it is safe to say that by 1975, bearing in mind all of the customary international law that preceded that point in time, persecutions was well established in international criminal law. Article 6 of the Charter of the International Military Tribunal found that persecution on political, racial or religious grounds is a crime against humanity. Article 5 of the Charter for the International Military Tribunal for the Far East found that persecution on political or racial grounds was a crime against humanity. The UN General Assembly Resolution 3 states, taking note of the definition of war crimes and crimes against peace and against humanity contained in the Charter of the IMT, dated 8th of August 1945, and essentially proves of the IMT Charter the fact that persecution, implicitly that persecution was found to be a crime against humanity in the IMT Charter. The UN General Assembly Resolution 95, which affirmed the principles of international law recognized by the Charter of the Nuremberg Tribunal, again, as I keep repeating, but where persecution had been found to be a crime against humanity. UN General Assembly Resolution 2391, describing crimes against humanity as being amongst the gravest of international law, and providing that crimes against humanity, whether committed in time of war or peace, as they are defined in the Charter of the International Military Tribunal at Nuremberg on the 8th of August 1945. Persecution was also included as a crime against humanity in the ILC draft code of offences against the peace and security of mankind. Find that at Article 2, subarticle 10, persecution on political, racial or religious or cultural grounds. Also in the 1954 draft, Article 211, inhuman acts such as, etc., persecution committed against any civilian population or social, political, racial, religious or cultural grounds. Also, and I failed to mention, the persecution was also found, was also incorporated in Control Council Law number 10 as a crime against humanity. I mentioned to you earlier, the body set up by the Allied powers, by the Soviet Union, France, the United States, and the United Kingdom, the bulk of the lesser war criminals compared to the International Military Tribunal. In 1961, in Israel, Adolf Eichmann was found guilty of crimes against humanity, including persecution of the Jews on national, racial, religious and political grounds. And in 1985, the French courts allowed for the issuance of an indictment for persecutions against innocent Jews committed during the Second World War. I think I've run out of my time now, but this is my submission that by 1975, the crime of persecution is a crime against humanity was well established in international customary law. I'm obliged for your attention, Mr. President. Thank you very much.
Monsieur le Président, je vous remercie de votre attention.
The Defense Council, you now have the floor.
Je laisse la parole au Council
Kong Retiri.
Maître Kong Retiri.
Good morning, Mr. President.
Bonjour,
thank you, Your Honour.
Bonjour,
Monsieur
le Président. Je vous remercie. Bonjour, Mesdames et Messieurs les
As
juges.
As a counsel representing my client
représentant
and his interests,
mon client et ses intérêts,
And we already conclude that the ECCC has no personal jurisdiction over him, as well reiterated yesterday. That's why we did not submit a written submission in response to the appeal brief by the co-prosecutors.
Au mémoire en appel des co-procureurs.
This is the main reason we did not submit the response.
Pour laquelle nous n'avons pas déposé de mémoire en réponse.
Since we are obliged to respond to the prosecutor, and I have just obtained the comment from my client that we should not respond
to
the prosecutors. However, we, after discussion, he agreed to allow us to
avec lui, give notre client
brief
finalement nous
response to the prosecutors,
de
and we will be very
brief. Nous serons en effet très brefs.
To respond in relation to the definition of crimes against humanity,
la définition
although
de crimes contre l'humanité.
Other practices at international tribunals create jurisprudence, but the definition in relation to the crimes against humanity has not been well defined.
N'est pas, bien arrêté.
However, we can refer to Article 188 of the Penal Code of Cambodia regarding the crimes against humanity.
Sur le crime contre l'humanité.
We may refer your honors to that particular article, please.
Si en fait on peut, si je pouvais porter votre attention à cet
article. Khietakam, ka salap rongkiel, ka thvoe tei chitea sakor, ka nie te hru chumliet doi.
These crimes against humanity, of course, include the enslavement and other deprivation of the rights and the freedom of the people, including torture, rape,
notamment la torture,
sexual slavery, forced prostitution, and other forms of rape, which have equivalent gravity, and also the attack on political and racial background, the forced disappearance and systematic inhumane act, for example, like the introduction of the apartheid regime. Your Honours, I am here in the middle of two countries.
Comme d'autres infractions.
The country, in the middle of the country where civil law tradition
nous sommes dans
is
un pays où
well
le droit romano-germanique est bien
for this reason,
appliqué.
The court shall reject any interpretation in relation to the international jurisprudence based on the common law.
Jurisprudence internationale
and
we
common have
law.
Found that the elements of crimes against
nous
humanity must constitute two main elements. The objective and subjective elements.
L'élément objectif. Et l'élément
and that
subjectif.
The attack must be systematic. For example, the orders shall be rendered
exemple,
from the top. And that the report has to be made from the bottom up.
Il faut que
and that the execution, for example, has to be in a big scale, like mass execution.
Systématique, comme par exemple, des exécutions en masse.
And even in with regard to the rape has
viols.
To be in the form of systematic and large scale
doit être à grande échelle et systématique. Il faut qu'il y ait des incidents qui soient commis à grande échelle.
For that reason, if such crimes committed in such magnitude, it will be compliant with the Article 988 of the Penal Code and that of the practice at Nuremberg at Tokyo Tribunal. With regard to the rape incidents, as indicated by the co-prosecutors, that such rape occurred and that there were elements, enough elements to prove it. But we, the defense counsel, would like to challenge such assertion because the co-prosecutors seem to fail to have referred to
concrete evidence.
N'ont pas donné d'éléments de preuve
and
concrets.
That at S21 there was only
S21,
a case of rape and such rape was not
viol.
Done systematically,
ça n'a pas été,
which cannot be included as the elements of the crimes under the umbrella of crimes against humanity.
Sous la rubrique des crimes contre l'humanité.
Because a case of rape was
viol.
Well controlled action was taken by Dutch when he reported to his superior regarding this rape incident. Son Sen was informed, but his report was ignored by Son Sen himself. And Dutch took action.
Donc a pris des mesures.
And he changed the male interrogators, replaced them with the female interrogators to stop rape.
Une interrogatrice
cases.
Et a mis un terme
so, as I indicated, such rape was
ainsi
not
donc,
systematic.
Il n'y a pas eu
and if it was, it were committed in a more systematic way, we would not really challenge it. However, at S21, there was only one case of rape.
Il y a eu
and I may also
viol.
Refer you to the what happened here this day of Cambodia. There were rape
récemment
cases all across the country, but the government of Cambodia was not really prosecuted for the crimes and its rule, for example. And I also may refer you to the rape cases in Nanking, in Tokyo, and such rape
au procès de Tokyo.
For example, was conducted in a very large scale, and sexual harassment was also conducted in a more systematic way that they could be included under the crimes against humanity. In Yugoslavia, the soldiers discriminated against women there, for example, the Albanian people who follow Islam
les Albanais
religion and they have suffered a great deal from such abuses. However, the commander of the militaries in Yugoslavia did not take any immediate action to really stop such incidences from happening. And such abuses were ordered by the government.
Ont été commis sur l'ordre des autorités.
As I indicated, that in such incidents, the rapes situation were conducted in a very large scale, which is completely different from that of the incidents at
S21.
Enslavement.
Pour ce qui est de la
réduction there is no international recognized definition,
il n'y a pas de définition
regarding enslavement,
reconnue au niveau international
but
en matière de réduction de l'esclavage.
We can refer to Article 188 of the Penal Code to find the elements of the enslavement.
Pour retrouver les éléments constitutifs de la réduction en esclavage.
According to the general education, normally when the crime of enslavement is charged,
pour qu'il y ait crime
elements, for example, like the deprivation of private ownership, shall be established as well, not just the forced labor or enslavement itself. Here,
du travail forcé ou de
during the Khmer Rouge, people were detained, but if I refer you to the incident happened in China, for example, when people were subjected to hard labor, but again, these elements could not be concluded as elements of the crimes against humanity or enslavement.
De crime contre l'humanité ou de réduction
and
d'esclavage.
We challenge the notion that condition at S24 constituted to the enslavement. During that time, people could roam freely.
Les gens
for example, people were equally treated
Although they were detained, they could really move places when they went to work. And that not only the prisoners were under strict control, even the cadres of the Khmer Rouge also were under great control. And my client in particular did not really contest or has never contested such interrogation and execution that happened at S21 and S24. Punishment were employed at S24 in relation to only his subordinates who committed some wrongdoing.
And membres du personnel qui
commettaient des coupables. People were only interrogated, tortured, and executed. Those who entered S21 could never get out alive. So there is no element at S21 to implicate my client for the charges of crime of enslavement.
Client pour le crime de réduction à l'esclavage.
And we would like to conclude our submission, and my client would not wish to make any further submission in relation to the response to the prosecutor concerning rape. And regarding the co-prosecutor's submission concerning the cumulative convictions,
aux déclarations cumulatives de culpabilité.
Cumulative convictions is the discretion of the judges according to Article 39. And that the term for sentencing is between 5 years and life imprisonment. So any sentence term ranging from 5 years to life imprisonment is proper because even
peut donc être prononcé.
Regarding these cumulative convictions, they already covered the sentence term because the convicted person has been rendered or sentenced to the maximum of the sentence term between 5 years and life imprisonment. But in the case of my client, he has been credited for his cooperation
and also his du fait qu'il a coopéré avec le tribunal,
expression of remorse, for example.
Et du fait également
but
de
I can feel that the prosecutors
mais
seem to have applied double standard of law regarding this sentencing. Because my client should have been credited for the mitigating factors, and the mitigating factors, if my client are credited for, then there could have been even reduced sentence term, for example, to 15 years imprisonment.
And
I would feel that 15 years term would be adequate already for his good gesture.
Suffisante, vu
I would not to elaborate further on this, since it is not our position to respond to the co-prosecutors concerning their appeal brief. And we still maintain that the ECCC has no personal jurisdiction over Deutsch.
Donc.
And since we are asked by the Supreme Court chamber
la
to respond, then we take the opportunity to do so. But again, it is not from our intention to respond to the prosecutor. We would like the Supreme Court chamber to look at the mitigating factors when rendering the final decision against my client.
Infligé à mon client.
Some other like I'm pulling
with that. Mr. Conrad Thierry continues. We would like the president and the Supreme Court chamber, the president concludes. Counsel, could you please now be directed to address the matter of mitigating circumstances or factors at a later stage because we are already reserved the session for
plus
that.
Tard pour ce qui est des circonstances atténuantes. C'est un point qui sera abordé ultérieurement dans nos débats.
The President, the Defense Counsel, would you wish to add further on this?
Est-ce que vous avez encore quelque chose à dire sur ce point?
Counsel Casswood, good morning, Mr. President. Good morning, national and international judges and the court. Please allow me to elaborate a little bit concerning crimes against humanity. According to Article 129 of the Constitution of Cambodia, the due process shall be compliant with the existing laws. This ECCC court is the chambers in the courts of Cambodia, and that it shall apply national law. For that reason, we may refer you to Penal Code Article 188, which is about the crimes against humanity and the elements. For example, the existence of armed conflict, which has been the element compulsory. Crimes against humanity shall mean any of the following acts when committed as part of a widespread or systematic attack directed against any civilian population. According to the international customary law, it shall only be implemented in relation with the communication between states and that they are not related to individual conducts.
Au comportement
so individuals
individuel.
Shall not be put accountable under the international law
au titre du droit international,
which is not really obliged by the constitution, for example, of the tribunal in Nuremberg. Between 1975 and 1979,
entre 75 et 79,
there was no such a provision.
Cette disposition n'existait pas.
And that individuals could not be
il était pas possible
prosecuted
for
the crimes
des personnes individuelles
committed before during this period.
Et il n'est pas possible
if Cambodia can apply customary law. But at the cost of the violation of Article,
peut appliquer le droit coutumier international
the rule of the ECCC, then the chamber shall first look into the elements and the offenses, each offense
les infractions
of crimes against humanity, what they are,
savoir quels sont ces éléments constitutifs,
the offenses and elements of crimes against humanity cannot be interpreted unless the existence has been established first. According to the Constitution of Nuremberg and the existing national law, the elements of crimes against humanity require that the existence of nexus of armed conflict is established. Between 1975 and 1979, there was no clear indication of such existence. This means that if we look at the crimes committed between 1975 through 1979, there are no clear elements concerning the elements of crimes against humanity. Even though there were some offenses
même si certains crimes,
committed by the CPK,
certaines infractions plutôt ont été commises par le PCK,
the conclusion was drawn that the crimes committed in the means to purge the internal enemy, and it was not really
in part of the armed conflict between Cambodia with Vietnam or Thailand. So according to the ECC law concerning the crimes against humanity, it can be noted that if such interpretation is done so, it is a setback of rule of law.
On notera que
the international law prohibits any trial after the crimes happened. In other words, law does not really have the retroactive effect.
Car on ne peut appliquer le droit de manière rétroactive.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Merci,
and your honors. The President, the co-prosecutors now have the floor to reply to the Defense Counsel
response.
Very briefly, Your Honours. My learned friends across the world stated that the rape itself within S21 would have to be on a widespread or systematic basis. Indeed, there is only one episode of conduct that could amount to rape at S21, but I would take issue with that interpretation of the law, and I think it's now well founded within international jurisprudence that it's only the attack itself that needs to be widespread or systematic, not the individual act of rape of the accused, of the rape of the victim. And in fact, you can find that within the trial judgment where they, in fact, identify at paragraphs 300 and 301 of the trial judgment, they explain very clearly that a widespread attack may refer either to the cumulative effect of a series of inhumane acts or the singular effect of an inhumane act of extraordinary magnitude. And then at paragraph 301, only the attack, not the underlying acts, not the rape, must be widespread or systematic.
Sous-jacent à cet acte doit être généralisé ou systématique. L'acte peut donc être isolé.
The President. It is now the floor for the co-rapporteur judge to put questions to the prosecutors.
Le tour est venu au juge qui souhaiterait poser des questions au coprocureur ou à la défense.
Thank you. I would have many questions, but since we don't have much time, maybe one of more general nature. We were being persuaded by the prosecution that notions of crimes for which the prosecution wants the accused to be autonomously convicted were known in international customary law since long. However, I would be curious to know whether the prosecution may present their position as to the concrete definitions of crimes as international crimes for the specific
period
of temporal jurisdiction of this court,
in particular the persecution.
I think, Your Honour, the fact is we all accept, as I stated in my submissions, that the definitions of these crimes have gradually crystallized. I think it is not unreasonable for this court to look forward to the interpretation by the Yugoslav War Crimes Tribunal and the Rwanda Tribunal, which clearly those courts
exercise judicial discretion in finding the elements of these offences. I'm not going to take issue with you at all on the basis that things were gradually developing after the Second World War. But if I was to guide you in terms of seeking precedent, or it's not precedent, of course, because it's looking forward, but to look for guidance on what the elements of these offences are, my submission to you would be that those courts essentially were looking at history and they made their determinations on the elements of these offences. And I think in my submission it would not be unreasonable for you to do the same, but I perfectly accept that matters were crystallizing in the period in the wake of the Second World War.
Qui se sont formées dans les années qui ont suivi la Deuxième Guerre mondiale.
The President, I have noted that the co-prosecutor was on his way. You would have the floor.
Sorry, Your Honour, it's a habit from my jurisdiction that I stand always when I'm addressing judges. I'll sit down. I don't know.
Non, je vais m'asseoir, Monsieur le Président. C'est simplement une habitude que je tiens de ma propre juridiction.
The President. The court will take the adjournment
nous allons maintenant
until
suspendre l'audience.
11 o'clock.
Nous reprendrons à 11 heures.
Hi, so,
security
je demande
officials are now advised to take the accused to the waiting room.
D'emmener l'accusé à la salle d'attente.
Okay.
Veuillez vous lever.
The greffier. All rise.